You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome to the sixth story for October 2023, issue 205. How have these stories been treating you thus far? Please let us know. I'm Kate at clarksworldmagazine.com. Thank you for your ongoing support of the magazine. Please go to patreon.com/clarksworld if you haven't already. And if you have, thank you so much. We are still fighting our way back from all that income we lost when Amazon made some huge changes. So any support that you can give would be greatly appreciated. Again, that's patreon.com/clarksworld. Our story is titled today, Post-Hacking for the Uninitiated. It's by Grace Chan. Grace Chan is an award-winning speculative fiction writer. She was born in Malaysia and lives in Australia. She writes about brains, minds, and space. Her critically acclaimed debut novel, Every Version of You, is about staying in love after mind uploading into virtual reality. Her short fiction can be found in Clarkesworld, Lightspeed, Fireside, and many other places. In her other life, she works as a psychiatrist. If you like what you hear, you can go back to He Leaps for the Stars, He Leaps for the Stars, and Jigsaw Children. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. PH. That's post-hacking for the uninitiated. And we're officially enemies of the civilized world, Callum said, pacing around the treatment room as I reclined with my injured leg propped up. He shot the arrest warrant into my circuits. The Peace and Stability Bureau of the Human Nations Assembly were beaming our likenesses across the galaxy. Fortunately, they hadn't identified us yet. Over the years, I'd layered false identities over us like a digital onion. Our purported crimes included treason against the Assembly, unauthorized access and distribution of classified information, multiple homicide and kidnapping. I watched as the medical droid extracted the last shreds of suthum from my foot, began to squirt antiseptic into the bullet wound. My little toe twitched. "Would you like another dose of painkillers, Garza?" the droid asked. "Kidnapping is a bit of an exaggeration," I replied to Callum. "I believe your mother came with us willingly, semi-willingly." "Will you stop pacing? You're making me feel like a lab rat." "And no." I turned to the droid, recognizing my false name after a short delay. "Thank you, but I'm a stoic." The treatment room was windowless, gray, and low-ceilinged, claustrophobic even for two people who spent most of their time on a dart ship. A live display of my physiological parameters scrolled on one wall. Another wall housed the droid, which consisted of an emotive screen, a speaker, and extendable arms bearing tools probing and sharp. A calciferous tang in the air made me suspect we were underground. "How is she?" I asked, not really wanting to know. After we landed on Pister, we had to prop Callum's heavily tranquilized mother up between us all the way through the station. The immigration clerk had scrutinized her skeptically until I dredged up a hastily fabricated document detailing a history of acquired brain injury. After he'd left me in the assessment bay of the industrial-looking medical facility, Callum had escorted his mother to a separate wing. Callum stopped. His thin shoulders had not stopped trembling since we'd left Zenshu. At least he'd had the sense to clean the chief minister's blood off his face. "The medics took her for pacification," he said. "You let them? What else was I supposed to do?" He stepped close and dropped his voice to a mutter. We've just put erased histories back into the common records. It's only a matter of time before the Assembly figures out who we are. Your foot's got a hole in it, and you look glazed as a donut. She's hardly there anyway." "Don't use me as an excuse for washing your hands of your mother's issues. She's traumatized, remember?" "Don't you think I know that? Fuck. I'm the one whose family was decimated by the Assembly. Do you want to book us into weekly psychotherapy? Some traumas can only be survived, and that's still a victory." I bit my lip, chastised. Callum was right about more things than one. Right now, I did more resemble iced confectionery than world-wise bounty hunter. I had little idea of how we'd reached this room, which deeply disoriented me. I usually kept my heat radar, tracking files, and all available maps and blueprints running whenever I was in a new place. At some point, back on the ship perhaps, I must have turned off my neural receivers because I wasn't linked to any communications. on or off planet. I'd only left a back channel open to the left-handed bandit. I tried to open an off-world newsfeed, but my controls were foggy. All I could focus on was the droid inserting two tendrils between my second and third phalanges to rummage for the bullet. My head was ringing like a temple bell. Maybe the pain I'd netted up in there was worse than I'd thought. I'd have to deal with it soon. After my control slipped yet again, I growled. What is that humming noise? What noise? Said Callum. Nothing. Just been a bit glitchy since we landed here. I started a hard reboot. The arrest warrant vanished from my retina screen. Tell me what's happening with the records. Callum's irises flickered as he filtered information. Millions of people have already accessed the unlocked records. Everything's visible, all the assemblies tampering and erasure. People are downloading and replicating and editing entries. Multiple versions, many of them conflicting. Sounds like chaos, he shrugged. Multiple threads of history reflect reality better than a singular whitewashed lie. People have been telling their own histories for ages. We just cracked open a way for them to shout across the galaxy. He paused and then added, there's more. Some people are angry at the assembly, but others are angry at us. Really angry. Of course. A lot of people like the way the galaxy works. With a wet sliding noise, the droid extracted itself from my foot, its steel fingers bloodied but empty. Ah, it said placidly. Target not acquired. My vision went hazy. I blinked hard, focusing on the two panes sitting like stones at the base of my skull. I unnetted the smaller one first. The release was a crest. Euphoria, tenderness, blinding light, and then waves of stabbing pain washing up inside my foot. I shuddered in the chair. Oh, just take the analgesia, Callum snapped. I gritted my teeth. I didn't like the stuff. I didn't like how much I liked the stuff. I have a better idea. Why don't you try some pacification yourself, kid? Callum laughed, a brittle noise. The droid was delving in for a second attempt. I guess it was at least 10 years old. Everything I'd seen so far on Pister looked clunky and outdated. It had a basic decision tree model to provide superficial conversation, but I could see no evidence of natural language processing. If my circuits were online, I could have pulled up its date of manufacture, model, and repairs history in a second. I tiptoed around the second larger stone, which was knotted with memory and grief. Encountering Callum's mother had inflamed something long buried. My own mother, who'd also been stolen, rewritten, and forgotten. I didn't want to unpick this net because the pain would peak and fade. It would multiply like a wildfire, singeing anything it touched. Bingo, declared the droid, waving its jointed arm high, bloody bullet in its filigree clasp. Bingo, Callum murmured, slumped against the wall. Excellent. Someone decided to make their medical droids quirky. His voice sounded like it was coming from the pit of a vast ravine. I opened my mouth to quip something undoubtedly scathing and witty in response, but my lips turned to rubber. My tongue melted like hot wax, and, as the humming escalated into a keening wail, my mind began to splinter. I thought I'd done it to myself at first. Surely no one could get close enough to know what machinery my body contained. I had been relentless in concealing every acquisition, every surgical procedure. But when I checked, the second pane was still a billiard ball in my cranium, the threads of my mother still tangled and unpicked. As much as I couldn't bear to admit it, someone was doing this to me. Fingernails were blading into the seams of my mind, searching for a weak point from which to crack me apart. It didn't hurt. Not in the manner of usual pain, at least. I was consumed by a distasteful intimacy, as though someone were peeling off my cuticles with their teeth, or tenderly stroking steel wool against my gums. In the light of this horrifying awareness, everything else receded. Callum spent in hollow and pretending not to be. A hapless droid, my punctured and still bleeding foot. Ship, I subvocalized, frantically signaling the bandit's channel. Ship. What's the history of this asteroid settlement? The left-handed bandit pinged back. Hello, Orin. Your signature's weird. Pister was colonized in the late 24th century. It was a mining settlement for the first 80 years. After the asteroid was depleted of precious metals, The Human Nations Assembly converted this to an administrative outpost. Currently, 84% of the population work as administrative clerks processing applications of citizenship, migration, parole, adoption, and so on. Your signature is getting weirder. Anything I can do? It's pro-assembly, I growled. I must have spoken aloud because I was vaguely aware of Callum looming over me saying something. Sorry, Orin. I should have looked more closely. On paper, they're neutral. But yes, most of the inhabitants lean elitist, or like the boots of. We need to get out of here. Can you pinpoint our location? A pause. Accessing local maps. You're in the Pister General Hospital, about 1.1 kilometers east of the Interstellar Station. The channel disappeared. Buzzing static recoiled across my empty, fracturing mind. I was slipping in the medical chair, damp with sweat. I couldn't find the bandit. I couldn't find the station or any other systems. I was muzzled. Someone was in my body. I felt my weapons go, the neural link to my phosphorus grenades, my smoke and acid blasts, my holster. My radars went next, dissolving the heat signatures of Callum and the bodies in the neighboring rooms. To my horror, my retina screens failed completely, streams of overlaid information vanishing from my vision. I was being taken apart piece by piece. Callum's face was a ghastly mask stretching over me. Had his eyes always been so bloodshot and ringed in purple? Why was his mouth pulled back so strangely from his teeth? He must be screaming, typical Callum, jaded at the best of times, overdramatic when he should be cool-headed. I gritted my teeth. I summoned every fiber of resistance in my body to push my thoughts past the fuzzy static encircling me like layered petals, to force them along my bilious throat and my limp tongue and into the shape of words, carried in a puff of crackling air. Get me to Bandit. Callum had never seen Orin like this, not in the 10 years that he'd been on the left-handed bandit. Her eyes no longer moving sharply as she processed incessant flows of information. Her mouth loose, not smirking. Her head lolled. What's that humming noise? What noise? He could only hear the clicking and whirring of the hapless droid, and even that came to him muffled, as though through glass. Since they'd left Shenshu, he'd felt like a puppet. Bamboo cylinders linked with string loops, limbs and torso and head knocking against each other. Someone else speaking with his throat, with his mouth. The muscles in Orin's neck grew ropey as she raised her head. Sweat made a triangular puddle just above the knobs of her collarbones. To Bandit. To Bandit. They'd already committed treason against the Assembly and become fugitives. What's another layer of catastrophe? The droid's arm, needle and thread, a red ribbon wound. He pushed the machine aside, encountering a surprise resistance. He wasn't in the hospital. He was back in the bandit's bunk, wrestling with his mother, pinning her silicon-smooth arms to her sides as she shrieked. He fastened the restraints taut across her birdcage chest. He slid his arms under Orin's and pulled. She slumped against his chest. He staggered backwards. He scanned over Orin's body. Most of her tech was already offline, unreachable. How? It wasn't possible to hack Orin. She was untraceable. She was assembled from unknown parts. Moreover, the settlement should have offered protections under general sanctuary legislation. He probed the shell of the hospital. His bioware wasn't sophisticated, but he could tell. Something wasn't right. They were undefended, exposed to the unfathomable black. Tian, surely they're not hacking your legs. A laugh sputtered from the beaconer's lips, filling him with relief. Beyond, a frictionless corridor stretched in both directions. The walls were jigsawed together from steel panels. The joints and rivets counted themselves in Callum's head, accompanied by a ringing gong. 12, 13, 14, 15. The ceiling was a fluorescent river, pressing achingly on his eyes. When had he last had a drink of water? His throat was scraped dry, his tongue a bloated leech. A red-robed figure sat behind a U-shaped desk, moving items on a digital display. Callum couldn't see an exit. We'd like to be discharged? Fuck. He'd always meant to ask Orin to tutor him in the basics of bluffing. What I mean is, we have urgent matters to attend to, far from here, on Phobos, actually. Her mother has been in an unfortunate accident. Our other mother. Yeah, we're siblings by adoption. What exactly had happened when they'd arrived on Pistar? They docked in a bay next to a grimy C-class passenger shuttle that looked like it had been parked there for years. An android had ushered them into a cylindrical transport capsule, and they'd whooshed along an opaque chute for several minutes. The acceleration and deceleration pattern suggested a pneumatic tube, and the structural supports indicated ascent beneath the surface. When they disembarked at the hospital, medical staff in red robes had checked their vital signs with soft hands, speaking in accented but precise common. The red-robed attendant told Callum he'd have to sign a waiver. The attendant's shoes peeked out from under the desk, red fabric shoes with finicky cloth fastenings instead of buckles. The seams scuffed gray and slightly fraying. Indoor shoes, not outdoor shoes, certainly not shoes for spacefaring. Callum nodded. Why was he covered in sweat? Was it his or Oren's? His arms ached from supporting the beaconer, whose head was drooping against his shoulder, her mouth twitching feverishly. You won't feel a thing, little girl. Great. He wasn't getting any help from her. The waiver was way too long to digest, over 80 pages with 450 items. A spot at the end to place his bioprint. Callum's heart stuttered in his chest. Was this a joke? He was in a small gray room now with four of the red robes around him. The air smelled recycled like dusty shafts and cleaning fluids. They'd laid Oren out on a stretcher and were plucking at her garments. They were nervous, Callum realized. Nervous and powerless. Which meant that they could go one of two ways. Nerves could explode into fear and adrenaline. They might do something rash, regrettable, even violent. Or if he applied pressure at the right points, the psychological equivalent of a jab to the solar plexus, so precise as to be hardly felt, they might fold. When I was very little, maybe 5 or 6 Earth years old, my mother and I accompanied my father on a diplomatic assignment to a Kuiper Belt settlement. We were there for perhaps 2 months, but to my child self, it felt like forever. During the stay, I developed an infected molar. My father took me to the local dentist, who informed me that he would pull the tooth and replace it with a synthetic one. I still remember the feeling of lying back in the dentist's stretcher, staring up at a constellation of light bulbs as he filled my mouth with anesthetic gel. "You won't feel a thing, little girl," he said, bestowing me a pearly smile. I didn't feel pain, but there was an indescribable horror in the way his hand rested rubbery on my cheek as the gel made a chemical swamp of my mouth. A curdling anticipation as he probed the infected molar, the clamp, the cold, the wrenching back and forth, my jawbone creaking like an overloaded chair. The sudden release, my skull recoiling, an empty socket pouring forth bitter pus and tangy blood. Then a new object, drilling into me, affixing itself into my bone. My tongue roamed the prominence of the foreign body for weeks, working away the taste of the man's hands until I could taste only iron and stone. It turns out that being hacked is like having teeth pulled and replaced all over your insides. It was difficult to focus on anything else. I knew in a distant corner of my mind that I was being dragged down a long gray corridor. I could smell, at some remove, Callum's lapel against my nose, his familiar scent a mixture of grease, coffee, and the menthol balm he'd like to rub on his chest. The intruder had already dismantled all my external enhancements. My radars and my retina screens were inert. The software turned to dust. Now I could feel them fragmenting my inner layers of security. They were as relentless as the assembly's terraforming machines, designed to keep scraping, digging, pummeling, and remaking, even in the most unfavorable conditions. When my interpreting networks were pulled apart, I drifted outside myself, swaddling in a cloud of frothy spaciousness. Countless conversations stored in my head no longer made sense. I had a memory of their meaning, but the memory was distorted. Immobilized and blind, I could only rage at myself. I'd guarded constantly against this eventuality. Every digital shield I'd constructed, every new piece of technology I'd incorporated into my body, had been designed to wall me in. How could I have overlooked the fissure through which this attacker had slipped? I suppose our identities are like the kushidama that my mother used to fold. Intricate strength, held together by tension and adhesion, but vulnerable to collapse if enough parts are removed. Aren't we, after all, stories we construct out of our memory? How many memories can you subtract before the story collapses? I knew where the intruder would go next. I felt them descend into the places where organic and synthetic interwove until they were indistinguishable. Needling fingers wrapped around my memory chips and began to peel. Microexpressions. Callum was sure that Oren had talked about microexpressions, on and off, over the years. The curl of one's lip or a quirk of the eyebrow could convey disdain and superiority, without the other person consciously realizing why they felt as small as a beetle. Callum conjured a regal, self-satisfied version of himself and contracted his facial muscles. The red robes took a step back. He plunged his hand into the bioprint scanner. The laser seared off a sample of his DNA. The waver vanished. One of the red robes leaned over him. Callum could smell garlic on the man's breath, and images of possible lunches sprang to mind. A cold, garlicky cucumber salad? A toasted baguette plastered with garlic butter? A large bowl of garlic and cheese spaghetti. How did the inhabitants of Pister obtain garlic anyway? The settlement did not look like the sort of place that would have extensive hydroponic farms. Were the bulbs specially imported from off-world? Callum recalled luscious, leafy greens stir-fried with garlic and sesame oil. When was the last time he'd eaten such a dish? His mouth watered incongruently. The red robes were trying to remove Oren's weapons belt, but they stopped after it emitted a sharp hiss, a spray of minuscule darts. Expressions of consternation, one red robe clutching his hand in pain, a muttered conference, then a wall panel slid open, and they were marching down another great corridor, indistinguishable from the first. The room numbers were counting off to that terrible gong in his head. 7, 21, 7, 20, 7, 19, 7, 18. The injured attendant peeled off to get his hand seen to. The remaining three pushed Callum and the stretcher into a creaking elevator. They rode to level 10, disembarked, and walked down more corridors. 10, 14, 10, 15, 10, 16. Until they reached another elevator. This was not the fastest route to the station. Callum recalled the view of the settlement as the bandit had approached. There were no tall buildings at all. The hospital was surely under the surface. Did ascending numbers mean they were going further underground? Callum glanced down at the stretcher. Oren was no longer fretting. Her features were smooth in unfamiliar serenity. He was surprised to realize how unmoored he felt without her presence, as though he'd stepped out of an airlock without a tether. Sure, he'd only recently run off from the bandit and gone wandering in Shenshu. But that was different. He'd known, gambled, that Oren was on his tail. Right now, he had no idea where she was. He side-eyed Oren's weapons belt. Although it was unlinked from Oren's neural networks, it retained its intrinsic functions, those tricky automatic microdarts, various kinds of grenades and chemical blasts that he couldn't identify, and a compact firearm. Back in that room, the red robes had conferred, but they weren't just talking to each other. Their visors glowed yellow. In communication with another party. The red robes were stalling for time. This whole convoluted march was an extended pretense. That could only mean that Oren and Callum's false identities were compromised. Who was on the way? Assembly goons, no doubt. He'd traveled with Oren for 10 years. She'd followed him and hauled him out when his messy pass had snapped at his heels. But when it came down to it, he knew shit all about her. He knew that she had an earthbound father and a Jovian mother. He knew that she hated talking about either one of them. He surmised that the father was a prick and the mother was gone, in some sense of the word. Once a year, Oren would swing by a sparsely populated planet called Ikeba and pick up a large serving of spicy peanut stew with rice. He knew that she liked to do extravehicular activities for exercise. He knew that her bond with the bandit was one of the strongest things he'd ever encountered in the galaxy. Level 14. He was sure the elevator was descending. He had no idea how to get out of this labyrinth. How much did he and Oren trust each other truly? She'd followed him to Shenshu. Surely that meant something. Would she have prepared for the opposite circumstance, a situation, unlikely as it would have seemed, where he might be the one rescuing her? Callum stretched his arm, reaching behind his back for Orin's weapons belt, already bracing for the stubborn holster the sting of microdarts. He couldn't imagine she'd have granted him biosignature access to her gun. But he could only try. I'm naked and falling through a strange void. How did I get here? Swirling ponderously around me are the spheres of various sizes and colors. Some of the spheres are veined in pink and white like marbled flesh, cut in cross-section. Some have the mottled gray of a corpse well into rigor mortis. Others are bruised purple like overripe plums, thin skin poised to rupture and release their liquefied contents at the slightest pressure. I can't feel any resistance at all, so I can't tell how fast I'm falling. I could be dropping like a stone or drifting like a bubble. I tuck my legs in close to my chest, trying to make myself as small as I can. I don't want to touch the spheres, but it seems like I won't be able to avoid them. They're increasing in number, bouncing against one another. Soon they'll surround me in a narrowing tunnel. As I float towards a freshy bauble, I stick my legs out so that my bare feet collide with it. Its clammy flesh recoils like a trampoline and flings me back. I barrel across the void, arms pinwheeling, completely out of control, yet my terror has an odd, muted quality to it, as though I'm only remembering that I'm terrified. As though this has already happened to a past version of me. I zoom toward an aubergine-colored globe. As I smash into it face first, I spread my arms and legs wide, embracing the tissue paper skin even as it ruptures. Massive globs of clotted syrup explode outward and envelop me in sticky warmth, coating my legs, my torso, my breasts, my lips, and my eyes. Something cool and gentle presses my cheek. My eyes fly open. A frilly duna is crumpled over me. Wister, our family's android, peers into my face, eyes wide with concern. Her voice is hushed as she urges me to grab only a few of my most important belongings and hurry to the transport bay. What time is it? Where are we going? Where's Mama? I'm bleary with sleep, stumbling around my bedroom. Wister passes me my favorite backpack, the one patterned with blue ocean waves. I stand there helplessly for a moment. All Wister can say is, "Hurry, hurry. Mama is waiting in the transport. We must go. Mama asked me to fetch you." "Where's Papa?" I try as I grab my handheld journal, my favorite boots, and the smallest of my model spaceships. "He went for a drive," Wister says, tugging me through the darkened house. We walk past Mama and Papa's rooms, which are quiet, the doors open, everything orderly. Through the window above the stairs, a nearly full moon illuminates the usual view, the rugged Riviera coastline, wind thrashing the ocean onto the rocks. Nothing seems out of the ordinary, but the air tastes wrong, as though something died and was taken away. But a trace of rot lingers. We take the lift down to the parking bay. Papa's yellow cruiser is absent. The open door to Mama's sleek white transport is a glowing purple square in the darkness. I climb in, but Wister does not. I seize the android's wrist, but she shakes her head. "Mama asked me to create a diversion." Wister kisses me with cold lips and shuts the door on my cries. Mama is already strapped into a chair. Her skin bears a greenish undertone, but she soothes me with pats and caresses when I climb into her lap. She points at the chair next to her, gesturing for me to buckle in. I sob harder.
"Where are we going? Why can't Wister come? Why are you talking, Mama?"
Eventually, she pushes me off and I strap myself into the other chair. She holds my hand as the transport zips through silent, moonlit streets. My hand trembles. I realize Mama is the one shaking. Her eyes are fixed on the ceiling, bright and unseeing. She has wrapped a green scarf around her head, but creeping down from her hairline is a tendril of dark blood. Mama swipes. It smears like red oil across her brow. All the way to the airfield, she doesn't speak. She doesn't explain why we're fleeing with such urgency. I don't yet know that I'll never see Earth again, that Callisto will become my new home. At the time, I'm angry with Mama because I think she's willfully keeping me in the dark. Only later do I discover that she can no longer speak. That Papa, in a fit of rage, had stolen the implants that supported her language centers and perhaps other invisible pieces of her, too. On Callisto, I watch Mama working in her studio. The window's bamboo shutters are propped open, letting in a temperate breeze. The gardens stretch to the habitat's glassy edge. Beyond that, the landscape is bare, the faint specter of Jupiter veiled in the sky. Mama's papercraft hangs from the ceiling in clusters on the shelves. Complicated boxes with secret latches, architectural baubles, snowflake-like marvels of engineering. But today, Mama is doing calligraphy. Shirt sleeves rolled up to her elbows, she bends over her low table, brush flicking and curling. I sit cross-legged at the other side of the studio, playing with paperweights. Papers scatter across the floor, all marked with the same word. Shadow. In the Jovian language. Shadow. 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 Mama likes to work in intense repetition. She can spend days writing a single word. Occasionally, Mama's lips move. Shadow. Shadow. Slowly, Mama relearns words, but she doesn't use common. She seems to develop an aversion to it. If we're at the market and people start conversing in common, she swiftly guides us to another aisle or finishes her shopping at double speed. For unavoidable transactions, she brings an embarrassingly old-fashioned translation droid. I learn the Callistoan dialect of Jovian with her. Back on Earth, she'd spoken it to me in private, but I'd never absorbed the way I did common. I learn the word for father, but I don't say it in Mama's presence. My mother is many things, soft and nimble hands, a laser beam of focus, a shield, and a fortress, but she is no longer articulate. I'm not sure what pieces of the past she still holds within her, and I'm too afraid to ask. I am consumed by a white-hot sensation that I don't understand. It's like anger, but I don't know what or whom I'm angry with. I only know I'll never let myself be vulnerable like Mama did. I'll make myself both slippery as a shadow and hard as steel so no one will be able to get inside me. 2 years after we fled from Earth, my mother looks up from her desk and speaks my name again. Not my first name, which Papa used, but my middle name. The Callistoan one. The one she gave me. Jorinye. She calls across the room, her voice creaky with disuse, her face shining with grief. Jorinye. I stumble toward her, my expression, a mirror. I stagger through a maze of dark caverns. Faint light comes through thin cracks in the rocky ceiling. My naked body is covered in globs of congealing liquid. From time to time, I can hear the soft hum of an elevator descending, a murmur of hushed voices, the vaguely familiar scent of grease and menthol. Soon, I hear footsteps echoing and stopping a half second behind mine. Someone is following me. I know I must face them, but it takes every ounce of my willpower. Eventually, I reach a cavern with no exit. I place my palms against the cool wall, take a deep breath, and turn around. I am nose to nose with my father, who looks as pristine and godly as when I was a child. Get the fuck out of my head, I snarl. He smiles beatifically. His profile shimmers. No, this is not my father. This intruder is tunneling into whatever is left of me. Rage whitens my vision. Go ahead. Take me apart. You don't know what traps I've laid in my mind. Those wide lips, shrouded by a trimmed beard, creak apart. Orin, the beaconer, he says, in that dulcet earthward accent. Not only are you weaker than I had expected, you're also stupider. Do you and your gutter-born friend really think that tearing apart the common records will make the galaxy a better place? The taste of anarchy will teach you the meaning of regret. I want to give a biting reply, something about how I'd stick any knife into the flank of the corrupt, bloated assembly, but language and reason are deserting me. Someone is lifting jigsaw pieces out of my head, leaving me as mute as my mother. Fuck. Assembly is the best I can manage. My father smiles again. You were far too easy to find. He reaches out to enclose my skull in his two large hands. My world grows dark. Callum's body felt crisply hollow, as though someone had pummeled through him with a giant apple corer. He was out of the hospital. Somehow he barreled through an emergency exit, pushing Orin's stretcher, tripping an alarm of some sort, a high-pitched oscillating wail to match the one in his head. Somehow, before that, he'd pulled Orin's gun from her belt without being porcupined by darts. He'd waved it around above his head. The red robes had plastered themselves against the elevator walls. He'd almost felt bad. Now, he was running along a smooth metallic concourse, boots skidding, knees buckling, gripping the stretcher for support. Orin looked terrible. Her cheeks were as gelatinous and gray as Soothem. Every so often, she would let out the rasping, shuddering gasp of a person in death throes. In between, she hardly seemed to breathe. He wondered if the hacker had wormed all the way down to her brainstem, to her primal functions. There were signs on the concourse wall, but his eyes couldn't resolve the symbols into words. Arrows up and down. Surely the tube station was down. The voice of a broadcaster overheard grew more urgent. Something, something, criminals run away from Pister General Hospital, armed and unpredictable. Avoid the vicinity, something, something. He tuned it out, picked an escalator, skidded onwards. As he remembered from their inbound journey, the pneumatic tubes were unstaffed and ran on an automated schedule. Callum and his unconscious companion charged into a cylinder. The plastic door swung shut behind them. Whooshing filled Callum's ears. He tried to sit, but his body wouldn't obey. His mother was still somewhere in the bowels of the hospital, wherever they kept people for pacification. He couldn't go back for her now. Apparently discarded and inconsequential, she hopefully wouldn't be seen as a bargaining chip. They'd just have to come back in the future to collect her. He'd swallowed. They would come back. Get me to Bandit, Orin had said before she'd fallen into the widening crevices of her splintering mind. Callum had heard something immutable, ecstatic in the tone of her voice. The Bandit was safety. He could feel it too, a desire to be back within the soft, familiar confines of their home of 10 years, to be cocooned by curved walls against a void of starry black. When Callum disembarked at the interstellar station, he saw the immigration officials at the other end of the platform, a channel to the Bandit. Maybe he could open one now that they were in close range. He dredged up his best neural link and flung it as far as he could with a desperate cry. The officials approached, their fabric shoes soft and sinister, their fingers beckoning for backup. He glanced down at Orin's slack face. Maybe this was the end. To be honest, they'd survived in the madness of the galaxy for much longer than he'd ever thought possible. It was a surprising thing, survival. To persist against all odds of disappearance and defeat, to remain despite the myriad forces of destruction. They'd spun their fates on a roulette wheel many times over, and they'd been lucky. Lucky enough. Take 5 steps back, Callum, said the left-handed Bandit in his head. He took 5 steps back. The ship landed on the platform in a blaze of engine glow. The outer door was open. Callum leapt up, reached down, hooked his arms through Orin's armpits, and pulled her on board. The door closed. He lay on the floor of the airlock as the ship shuddered into the air. Bring Orin to me. This was fantastic. Callum wished he'd lived his entire life like this, with a voice in his head telling him exactly what to do next. He dragged himself to his feet and hefted Orin up, and almost immediately fell over. They were a similar height, but she was heavier than him. Eventually, moving in an awkward lurch, she managed to shift into her chair in front of the dashboard. Her head drooped. This will be faster if you link her directly. Callum knew the beaconer had several hardwired ports on her body. He found the cable on the dashboard and extended it to its full length. He lifted Orin's hair and plugged the cable into the port at the nape of her neck. It clicked in and came aglow. What's happening? Callum asked. But the Bandit was whirring with frenetic activity, too occupied to reply. He slumped into the neighboring chair and glanced at the navigation screens. The ship had easily evaded the immigration officials and the station's clutches. Pister was already shrinking in their rear vision. He closed his eyes, just for a second. I opened my eyes. The vacuum of space was cold against my external shell, but my belly was warm. 2 bodies slumped on chairs within me, a ragged, slender young man and a wiry, dark-skinned woman with braided black hair. My mother. How could she be here? A cloud of fierce shame and aching affection shifted through me. Once, that shame had been directed at her. I hated her for subjecting us to my father. I'd blamed her for his weaknesses. I regarded her mutilation as just punishment for marrying him in the first place. Then at some point, I decided to wrap her up and put her in a sealed, opaque box inside my head. But as the hacker unraveled me, I'd seen her again. She wasn't the person I remembered. Soft and nimble hands, a laser beam of focus, a shield, and a fortress. I had forgotten, or refused to recall, so many things about her. Maybe my father had traveled to Callisto to find a young woman frantically paddling to keep her chin above the poverty line, to keep her in his house like an oriental tapestry. Or maybe, as the young interpreter assigned to accompany the rich Earth minister on his tour of Callisto, my mother had purposely used her wit and charm to grasp at a better future for herself. I'd never known their full story, but the shame was now for myself, for the way I'd underestimated her. I sank, and I shrank. I could no longer feel the stars. I was the woman in the chair. My mother was not here. The bandit's curving walls, familiar as my own skin, held me on all sides. My fingers probed the nape of my neck, closing around the cable. I yanked. A strange feeling went through me, like someone had pulled their hand out of my skull. To my left, Callum sat bolt upright. Oren, are you intact? More or less. I blinked to dispel a wave of giddiness. I turned to the dashboard and opened a search function. Shall we try sudden deaths and assembly officials? Although I bet the hacker's not assembly. Probably just another beaconer hired to do a job. Let's try sudden deaths and beaconers in the last hour. Orton, please explain what's going on before I decide you're delirious. The bandit is more than just my ship, Callum. The bandit is me. I back myself up to her mainframe every night. She carries parts of me I can't remember, memories I've long discarded. Callum stared at me, stunned. So, yes, I'm restored, although my recollection of the last day is somewhat patchy. A chime indicated a search result. A news snippet floated up on the screen, a civilian article posted 16 minutes ago about a beaconer who keeled over in a seedy Thernos bar, blood pouring from all of her orifices. The local police were trying to figure out her identity. How did you do this? Callum asked, his lips twisted in mild horror. I wrote a virus, buried in my memory centers. I checked the location of the Thernos bar and matched it to the nearest mortuary. If anyone hacks in deep enough, the viral code jumps into the intruder system. It's a little experimental. It gambles on them having RNA-generated nanobots in their system, which most professional beaconers do, mostly to improve their physical stamina. The code would instruct the nanobots to churn out one piece of messenger RNA on repeat. The messenger RNA would be translated by ribosomes into a sequence of amino acids, which link together into a protein, an enzyme. Their system is flooded with an enzyme that I modeled after the beta-hemolysin toxin, secreted by golden staph. It dissolves in the cell walls of red blood cells. Instant suffocation from losing all the oxygen carried by your red blood cells and seizures from severe electrolyte imbalance. Tiana, said Colum, his expression unchanged. What were you before you became a beaconer? Ignoring his question, I flicked through the photographs taken by the civilian journalist. They were surprisingly good quality. Black hair, a couple of tattoos, and on her index finger, a golden signet ring imprinted with an eagle. Ah, I'd seen that ring before. On the hand of the chief minister for sustainable development. Not just a beaconer then, but in bed with the corrupt elites. Was she really the one who'd rummaged around in my head? I could still feel the intimate terror of someone peeling away my functions one by one. A part of me was still standing in the dark cavern, pinned with my back to the wall. You were far too easy to find. My insights felt oily, tainted. I wondered if all the pieces of my mind had been put back together in the same way. I could take us to Thernos. I could examine the body to know for sure. But I knew the dead beaconer was just a weapon. There were others pulling the strings, people who were used to shielding themselves with less important bodies. People who'd managed to find me and take me apart in the space of a day. Callum's voice broke into my thoughts. Orin, you're forgetting two very important things. Oh? One, your foot's still got a hole in it, and two, you owe me a thank you. Thank you. Those wimpish bureaucrats wanted to hand us over to the assembly, remember? I saved our skins. I had to use your gun. You used my gun? Well, I waved it around. It was enough. Huh. A frightening image. Despite everything, I smiled, and Callum managed to return it. Your foot? Callum repeated, more insistent. He grabbed the battered first aid kit from an overhead compartment, rummaged around for clotting spray and bandages. I closed the display, vanishing the pictures of the dead beaconer, the route to Thurnos, and the new and alternate histories pouring into the freed common records. I could take us to Thurnos, but that could wait. I gazed through the viewport, my mind strangely quiet, as Callum tended to my injury. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment if you go to the Clarkesworld Magazine webpage itself. All of our contact information is listed. We have a few stories left for you for the month of October. I do hope you can come back and listen, should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.